thank you very much. So let me continue with the feeling and ask you one question. Perhaps you are the wrong audience to have this question. You should ask it to students. I think we all have some problems with in exams, and sometimes we blame the professors. So if you have a good student, has prepared very well, this doesn't exclude that the students can have difficulties in the exams. Where this comes from? I have at least three reasons. The problem type could be very strange to the students because it was not addressed in the in the class. Or the problem has high level of extrinsic complexity or high level of intrinsic complexity. What is extrinsic complexity? Imagine you want to test how good students are at minimizing a logical function using the K-map. So how would you ask the students a question? So this is one way. You can give them a word problem like this one, given a three-variable function, f of three variables, a, b, and c. The function is one when any two variables are one. Minimize this function using K-map. You could also ask them a question with less words and more specification. You give them that the truth table for this. Actually, both problem statements should lead students to the same K-map. So, but if your target is to test their skills in applying the K-map algorithm, then these two problem statements actually have, let's say, noise, actually. You are not, because here they may have more difficulties in analyzing the text than here. Here they map directly the truth table to the K-map. So, and I would call this extrinsic complexity as long as you are trying to test their abilities in minimizing the function by a given K-map. Yeah. So, but even if you give them the same problem statements and you give them even the K-maps, this doesn't mean that they have it easy necessarily. Here we have three K-maps. You could give the students these three K-maps and ask them to minimize. So in the first one, so they would try to find the prime implicants. This is one, and this is another one. Here a typical error that they forget this one, they forget to include this one with this one, and then they could make a mistake here. And then they write the minimized function if they identify the prime implicants correctly. So in the second one, we just moved this one from here to here, and we get this K-map. And as you can imagine, here the minimization is much easier than before. So you could remove this one, make it zero, and then the identification of the prime implicant is now much easier, but the students have to write more actually, yeah, because each term now has the three variables. Yeah. They must be more careful. So what is more complex, what is less complex? I call this the intrinsic complexity because it comes from the input of the problem itself, regardless of the presentation or the problem statements. So if you would like to see the impact of having different settings or different intrinsic complexity levels, so here we have 70. We gave 29 students 70 K-maps, and they minimized, and we determined the average solving time for them. So as you can see, they are distributed from less than 1 minute to more than 5 minutes it takes minimizing a Boolean function with four variables. So I regard this as significant because in the exam you could give the students a finite state machine problem with, let's say, five states and one input signal. then they may they have four functions to minimize. So for functions to minimize, if they were unlucky, you are here, and they would need perhaps 15 minutes just to minimize functions, whereas you are aiming to test them on the skills of developing a finite state machine, and the complexity has shifted towards actually minimization, yeah, because it's solving time is very important in the exam. I have more example in the minimizing Boolean, using Boolean functions, it is even worse. It can go more than 10 minutes for minimizing a function. So, and that's why I believe that it is worth investigation. What did we do? We tried to understand what factors affect the intrinsic complexity of a problem, a typical problem. We are talking about standard problems that you have in any course. Yeah. For example, calculating the amplification of an amplifier, calculating the frequency response PID control or whatever. Here we did this for digital logic design and for the basic transformations of digital logic design. So what we tried to make it inferential to predict the complexity of unseen problems, because I believe we don't have a bank of questions that we can rely on. So what problem classes we addressed? So if how can you specify a logical function or a digital function? You can use your human statement, like this example. The function is 1 if A and B are 1 or if C is 1. So the first transformation is to make a formal function out of this presentation. And this is the first basic transformation we looked at. So if you have the formal function, you can build a circuit out of it. And this is the second transformation, from formal function to digital circuit. But you can, if the function is complex, you can apply Boolean algebra to reduce the function. And this is the third transformation. And or you can set up the K-map and apply the K-map minimization procedure to get the minimized formal function. You can also give the students a truth table and ask them to write the formal function, or the other way around. You could give a formal function, ask them to truth table, and you could ask them to go from the truth table to the K-map. These are the transformations that we looked at. What is the complexity? What are the factors that affect the complexity of each transformation? The procedure that we used, how we did it, the methodology. So we have a problem class. What is the problem class? A problem class is like minimization of using K-map, minimization using Boolean algebra, transforming from a human statement into Boolean function, transformation from Boolean function into circuit. All these transformations are problem classes. So, and each one has a lot of problem classes. A Boolean function, I came up with four variables, has, if you calculate the don't care values, actually you have 65, more than 65,000 permutations. That means you have a lot of problems. If you reduce the symmetry, you get a little less, but it's still thousands of problems. That's why what we can do is we look at this problem class. What can affect the complexity of this problem class? For example, the number of ones in the map, the number of zeros, the number of prime implicants, essential implicants. What does it affect the complexity? According to our understanding as now professionals, what we get is potential complexity variables. This is part of the data. What we do next is we generate a problem sample. So I think some problems, like 70 problems came up problems, or 40 Boolean minimization problems, and so on. Then we let students solve these problems under time recording. We measure the time, and we feed this time and the error rate, that average solving time and the error rate for each problem into the data. And we have the values of the potential complexity variables, of course. So we apply regression analysis with this as the dependent variable and the potential complexity variables as independent variables, and we get a complexity model. The complexity model tells us how complex this problem is. So we apply then in the future, we could apply this model to a new problem, unseen problem, to determine its complexity so that we can give students reliable exams. This is the idea of. And this, the methodology itself was presented last year on IEEE Transactions on Education. So now, what were the results? The results, as I said, for these transformations were complexity models. For example, if you give the students formal function, ask them to set up the K-map, the complexity will depend on the number of variables and the number of, ST is for some terms, yeah. The minimization itself depends on the number of zeros in the map and the number of don't care values in the K-map, and so on. But this is not all models now. Not all models are on the same qualities. For example, these models are really much better than the other ones because they are straightforward, linear, actually. Yeah? But this model was the first one, minimizing using Boolean algebra, was really very, very, very difficult. Yeah. So what we did actually is much related to the item response theory. The item response theory, they provide, they specify problems in terms of difficulty and discriminations. So what the problem with the item response theory is that it has not the predictive power. Yeah? You have a bank of questions and you have a specification for each question. So what we use, we believe that it is very useful for designing reliable exams, you can then compare your exams with others' exams. You can compare even your exam with your exam in the next term. And we can now, because the question of marking and grading is always a difficult one, if we don't have a standard for the complexity of problems, we would always have difficulties in interpreting grades. So, and this is, I think, and this is very important. This is the initial work, and we are continuing this work, and I welcome any collaboration in this area. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Abdulhadi.